Fiona Walker is my guest on the book club today, and she's written the most amazing book that's quite sizzling and it's quite scorching. It's called The Summer Wedding. Thank you for coming into Magic, Fiona.
It's a pleasure.
I would ask you to give me your take on The Summer Wedding, but then you might give the whole story away.
Yes.
So let's start with the 90s and these college mates.
Yes.
Yes.
Four friends.
Yes.
Well, they're not friends, they're four strangers, but they become friends very quickly. Indeed. As one does at college.
Yes.
That first week, it's actually the very first day, they meet queuing to pay their fees, as one used to do. I was at university in the 90s. Well, in fact, Things were different.
Okay.
And it was great fun thinking about that. So these four friends, they're all studying drama, so they're all quite flamboyant. And we have Lainey,
yes,
who is, you know, she's the sort of most straight down the line. She wants to be Victoria Wood.
Oh.
So she's a bit of a quick comedy, but she's the daughter of two GPs who are both Amdram fans. And, you know, she's quite straightforward, and everybody else seems so wild and glamorous. And she starts by queuing next to this chap called Simon.
Yes.
Who immediately flirts full on.
Wonderful, okay.
Big long high woman's coat. Very sexy, very flamboyant. Turns out he's completely invented himself for going to university, and he's someone completely different. But that's him, and she meets him. Basically,
and she
on the first
likes
day of
what
his...
she meets.
Yes.
Regardless of actually knowing what's behind.
It's a character.
What she meets.
Exactly.
There
but
you go.
She gets to know the real him as
Ooh-hoo!
Well. And she's the only one he divulges the secret to.
Right.
And he basically says, don't tell
me. Well, don't tell me. Right.
So there is the two other, there's other glamorous couple who she completely gets completely wrong, because she thinks they're these sort of exotic, idle, rich. And one of them is Mia, who's the daughter of dairy farmers from Lancashire, really
right.
down-to-earth girl, first daughter of the family to go, first child of the family to go to university. And her new friend, and they're all new friends, is Leo. And Leo seems terribly exotic. His parents were in the circus together.
Is
Leo gay?
Okay.
It's like secret.
Because you don't actually...
don't know at the beginning.
Right.
And the whole point is, you know, again, I went to university, studied drama, 3 years with friends who later I met them and they were in sort of civil partnerships or gay marriages.
And you had no idea.
And you had no idea, but you'd also have that awful thing of meeting someone at a wedding, kind of, and, you know, it's where you all get together at weddings throughout your 20s and 30s. And you'd think they're bound to appear with sort of Quentin Crisp on there. And they'd go meet the wife and kids. And you're, crikey, because thought they were... So these wonderful sort of flamboyant drama students all meeting together. Leo, you don't know. And he's the sort of clucky mother hen of them all. And he's the youngest, and yet he's the most sort of loving and grounded. And he's got this incredible sort of sense of self. And he's very caring. And I love having a very caring male character who has that parenting type quality.
Right.
Because there's a lot about parenting here. But something happens
now
in that
film. Isn't Mia... Is it Mia or Maya?
Mia.
Okay. Leo isn't actually the love of Mia's life, though, is he?
No. Mia has this boyfriend who she's met through the National Youth Theatre. He's quite a bit older than her, although the joke is he was born on leap year day, so he's actually four. He is called Dominic. He's already a professional actor. He's been through drama school in London. He's a sort of look back in anger type character. He's the son of a coal miner. He's quite chippy. His acting's been his salvation through some pretty difficult times. He lost his mum when he was very young. And Mia and he are the great loves. They've met performing together at the National Youth Theatre in Troilus and Cressida. And he's now kind of broken through. But she's more the academic one. She's going off to university. And again, this is something I remember from being at universities. We all wanted to be actors.
Yeah.
But the real actors tended to be at the drama schools. And we were the ones that kind of... we had to write an essay about the secret of Japanese no theatre in order to do a bit of acting at the end of term. So, you know, we knew we were slightly kind of the second rung in terms of acting.
Now, it's Oliver, is it? The real love of Mia's life.
Dominic.
Okay. Yeah. Now, somewhere in the book, he disappears for a bit, doesn't he?
He disappears for a long time.
But she doesn't actually know why at first, does she?
No, she's in a big production at her college. And he's now acting professionally in Leeds, and she's taken all her friends up to see him in his play. And it's unheard of him to take a day off. And they've had this... Something's happened on leap year day, his birthday. She's made an absolute fool of herself. up there, and she thinks that he may never forgive her. And they've had these very awkward phone calls, and it's the days before mobile phones. We all had to feed these plastic cards into communal phone corridors. And it's always difficult having long-distance relationships. And he said he's going to come down and see her in this play. And she doesn't realise he's not in the audience, so she's acting her heart out.
And then realises he's not there.
And she's furious because and she doesn't understand why. And again, it's before mobile phones. Nobody knows where he is. And she gets very drunk at the after-play party and says, sod it, I'm going to get off with somebody else.
Don't give away the reason as to why.
Does she stop her.
Oh, okay.
Sort of. But there is a misunderstanding that night.
Yeah.
Which echoes back even 20 years later. The action moves on to 20 years later and they're all grown up. And so there's something, not just his disappearance, which is...
But it's the reason why.
Life-changing. The reason why. And also what the friends do that night aside of that.
Right. Because... there's a baby in here somewhere.
There is a baby. Let's leave it there. But the baby does get married.
Yeah.
In the summer wedding.
But because we jump forward a bit. But I want to just keep it with these four for now.
Okay.
Now, Lainey, she then branches out into radio. Now, is she presenting radio or is she writing radio plays?
Lainey has been a script writer.
Okay.
For years, sort of comedy script. She's written the scripts for a television soap opera. And then she's gone in, having had a checkered life of relationships, and she's written a film screenplay, which has rather been kind of stolen away from her. And now her bread and butter is in radio adaptation. It's basically adapting plays and novels for radio. And that's what she does for her day-to-day. She also writes film scripts and so forth. And she also, because of the way, as you know, radio works, and you obviously know it a lot better than me, she... is a great wit, and she's one of these. She's a great raconteur, and she's married to someone who's a celebrity, so her name has a bit of credence. So she's on a panel show, which she's an occasional guest on a panel show called Quick Wits,
right,
which has quite a high turnover of different people that come on to do this radio panel show. Mm-hmm. And she does that occasionally. That's her one little bit of fame, but really, she's a behind the scenes person.
Because isn't it Simon that's actually the one that's out there? Now, I couldn't quite work out, are they living together? Because he spends an awful lot of time in LA, doesn't he?
No, that's Simon and Lainey are very much the UK kind of. He's a small.
Who's the LA?
LA is Leo.
Ah, okay. Okay.
Now, Leo is rather because everybody thinks that Leo is going to go off. He wants to be a costume designer. His great passion is knitting. You know, he's very artistic. And he's ended up being the star, which nobody, because there they all were ambitiously in their first year at university, thinking they were going to be the next Alan Rickmans and Emma Thompson. You know, Lainey's ended up writing screenplays and occasionally appearing on Radio 4, you know, 12:30 on a Saturday. Mia has absolutely no celebrity at all, does lots of charity lunches. Simon has ended up judging Britain's Greatest Pork Pie and doing daytime telly, and his career has actually gone down and down and down. He's a bit sort of, you know, cable on a sort of early hours of a Tuesday morning. And there's Leo, who's been hugely successful and has translated and gone to America and has become this sort of swooning heartthrob. He's got all the British floppy, floppy hair and the kind of slightly clipped speech and the way of looking and being slightly embarrassed. And he's chased, you know, Kate Winslet up one escalator and Julia, what's her name, down the other. And it, you know, he's done lots of clinches with all the greatest actresses. And he's now doing, as many actors who've done mainstream films do, he's doing this studio-based television series, big network television series in America. And you are, they basically lock the studio door. I know someone who does one. And they just film back to back, 5 a.m. till midnight. And if you're a main star, I mean, there's House, where famously we didn't see Hugh Laurie for years, apart from looking bearded and stressed, occasionally getting off an airplane to see his children and going, oh gosh, you've grown. And then getting, oh man. So, that American studio system is really brutal. And Leo is now in America, so we don't actually see him for a lot of the book.
Right. But then we come forward 20 years because the product of a relationship now, and it kind of all takes the second part of the book to another journey,
which is where Leo is in his American book in the studio.
It sounds, as our colleague Zoe was saying before she left the studio, like a great film. Confusion and glitz and glamour.
Yes.
And secrets and lies. It sounds fantastic.
Well, I grew up on all those miniseries.
Yeah.
Which were fabulous in the 80s. And also the whole dynasty. Dallas. And the British Colbys version, I actually name checked it. Howard's Way.
Okay.
Which, one of the characters in the 90s section, they all think he's marvellous because he slept with one of the cast members of Howard's Way, but they all have to guess who it is. And of course, we don't realise we've actually got to guess the wrong sex.
Yeah.
So all those series I thought were brilliant. And I love the modern version. They all tend to have to wear corsets and frocks now. So you've got the sort of Downton Abbeys, which really are the modern day dynasties, where you get to know the characters over weeks. And you think, gosh, they can't introduce another twist. And yet it
they
happens.
Do.
So you think, gosh, and you see it bubbling, this romance can bubble within the half an hour episode, and then somebody else dies, and it's just fabulous. It just keeps coming at you.
And we love it, don't we? We love it. And it's definitely been displayed in between the pages of your book. Now, it's called The Summer Wedding. Is this going to be a good summer read?
It's very summery. I mean, it. I think it's got that beach read that effect that I love, which is that it will last you a good fortnight if you don't read terribly fast, but you can gut it in 3 days if you're addictive. And it takes you everywhere. So it's got lots of different settings.
Okay.
So it's got obviously the early stuff, which is set just outside London. Then you've got the Chilterns, where the two couples end up with houses. You've got Andalusia. And not the coast, you've got the wonderful dusty hills with the stud farms and the alfalfa, and then you've got the Serengeti, which is very exciting. And there's hot air balloons come into it. There's this theme of hot air balloons, and one of the characters flies hot air balloons over the Serengeti. And it is just the most amazing profession, the most amazing way to see. And I wanted to get that in. And then you've got the glitz of LA.
I love the way you get so involved in the storylines. It's not just something I get the impression you're not just sitting there writing or typing or whatever you do. I'm getting the impression that there are pictures in your mind and you're transferring them onto the paper.
I go into my office. It's like going through the back of the wardrobe.
Do you have a place where you actually
write? It's not very convenient at the moment. I used to work in a shed in the garden where we lived before, which was great. Mummy goes to her shed. But now Mummy's very conveniently through an obscured glass door. So my girl's kind of going, Mummy. And I've got also, it's right in the middle of the house. So I get all the traffic. And I also get, lots of you find the laundry box. I've been sorting out laundry and I suddenly have an idea. And that ends up next to me for 3 weeks. And my partner's going, I've got any pants. I'm like, oh, look in my office. Everything, all the Christmas presents, all the post, everything ends up in my office. And I've now set it up so it's also a sort of under seventh entertainment and sick bay. So one side, we've got this old laptop where I'll put my daughters and they write their novels while I'm trying desperately to finish. And on the other side, I've got this little sofa bed where if they're off sick, they lie with a little telly at one end. So it's, in fact, you could, it's self-contained. It's like a TARDIS in the middle of the house.
And it still amazes me that writers find a place to sit and write. Maybe it's a desk or, like you say, it was your shed, now this little glass office. And then that book, The Summer Wedding, resonates with so many people all over the country and all over the world. And that's what I love about authors. Fiona, thank you for coming into Magic. Thank you. Magic 105.4.